Just hold my hand.
As I travel through this pilgrim land, there is a friend who walks with me. He leads me safely through the sinking sand. It's the Christ of Calvary. And this would be my prayer to Lord each day.
Jesus.
Hallelujah, hallelujah. Page 180, everybody will be happy over there. This church, our music program really only goes about 25 minutes, unless the Holy Ghost really infuses into one of the songs. But I've been in churches where I've stood up for an hour and did praise and worship. And you say, well, I could never do that. Oh, you really could. Because the Holy Ghost gets in you. I understand you have a health issue. I really do understand that. But let me tell you, He is here to bless you this morning. He is here. He is here in this place. Hallelujah.
Place on Him the hope of it. Jesus is Nothing like the blood of Jesus. What can wash away my sins? Nothing but the blood. Nothing but the blood. Can you say thank you for shedding your blood for me, Jesus? Hallelujah. I am so glad that I am saved. I'm glad that I am with people that are saved. I am glad that Jesus still saves. Amen. Hallelujah. It's time for us to worship the Lord and give Him this morning. Can we just praise Him for that? Thank God His blessings are so real unto every one of us. Hallelujah. Thank you for being so faithful and given to God. And this past Wednesday evening after the service, we were able to share in our financial report. And I want to say thanks to so many of you who have given to the Joash Fund. And because of that, we're able to keep moving on with some of the projects that we had voted on and agreed to do. And so right now we're in the process of getting estimates and bids and things like that to help us to landscape and to do the parking lot. And we're talking about restripe that thing so that way you can see where to park. Amen. Some of you are saying, well, I'm not worried about, I know where to park. And somebody else may not know where to park. So it's always the other driver. You ever notice that? Always the other driver. But God is helping us. And I just want to remind you, maybe God's blessed you with a little extra money and you can just drop it in the Joash chest out front. And we'll get all that turned in. And I just thank you so much for your giving. We're going to do our prayer of confession at this time. So I want to ask if you would to stand with us. And once again, there come a time when I will quit explaining this because I believe everybody's going to know it. This is actually a prayer that is confessing what God has already done and what we're believing God to do. And so we're giving God praise in advance. We're giving God praise for what He has already done, and we're praising Him for answering our prayers. And how many of you know that's an act of faith? Yeah. Amen. That is an act of faith. So let's just pray this prayer together. Lord, upon the authority of your word, I boldly confess that I am a believer, and I thank you for fulfilling your promises to me. I thank you for the salvation of my entire family, those who are saved and those who will be saved. I thank you for revealing yourself to them. I thank you for filling them with the Holy Ghost and fire. I thank you for perfect health and healing in my life and for my family. I thank you that we walk in divine favor and blessings. I'm a tither and a giver. Therefore, the enemy is rebuked, the curse is broken, and I live under an open heaven. Hallelujah. I thank you for my job and a better job, for raises, bonus sales and commissions, interest and income, debts paid off, gifts and surprises. I'm blessed going in and going out. And all that I do will prosper in Jesus' name. Amen. And amen. Hallelujah. 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 Now I want to ask you to do something this morning. First of all, I'd like for the ushers to come, but just remain standing with me. Because I'd like for you to take your offering in your hand today. Nobody has to see what you're giving. If it's a piece of money, just fold it up. Put it in your hand. And as we begin to pray, I want you to give this to God. Can you do it, Father? Today, Lord, what we have to give unto you is so small compared to your blessings unto us. But today, Lord, I give unto you with a willing heart. I give unto you to God cheerfully. I give unto you to God because that you have blessed me to where that I can give. So, Lord, I pray today that the offering that I will give will be found acceptable and pleasing unto you. God, I trust you. I trust you to God with my offering, but I trust you, Lord, to take care of me and my family. And God, today I give unto you, Lord, from a heart of thankfulness. And God, a heart of appreciation. Lord, I worship you today in this giving. In Jesus' holy name. Amen. Thank you. given unto the Lord, and may God just richly, richly bless you. Hallelujah. It is so good to have you with us today. I'm looking around, and I don't know if anyone here would consider themselves to be visitors. I think everybody here, we just consider them to be part of the family. Amen. And I just appreciate you so much. But let me encourage you to be praying about what to give into the Joash Fund. This is how that we're going to keep the projects flowing. And I'm excited about what God is doing. I'm excited about our men's fellowship that we had yesterday morning. Man, if you didn't come, you missed out on a fantastic breakfast.
Yes.
And not only that, you missed out on some good time of fellowship. And I am excited about what God is going to do. Not just what He is doing, but what God is going to do. And I have some announcements that I need to make. The first one is, make sure you pick up a bulletin, because there's no way I can make all those announcements from up here. And I like to just keep the service flowing. Drama practice is today at 4:30, and also Wednesday evening at 7, and also Saturday at 4. So everybody in the drama, just mark all that down mentally or on your hand or something, and just remember to be here today at 4:30, and then we'll remind you about Wednesday and next Saturday. Okay? Also, our Easter egg hunt is for Saturday morning from 10 to 11:30. And if you can bring any type of goodies to go into helping out on that, it sure would be appreciated. Saturday, our widow and widowers are getting together at 1 o'clock in the fellowship hall with Sister Joan Baltman. And so widows and widowers, come on out. And then Sunday morning, we're starting revival with Brother Hanks, and I am looking forward to this. We're scheduled to go through Friday evening. On the 27th, we're having a volunteers meeting at 10 o'clock. If you work in any capacity in this church, I really compel you to do your best to be here. If you want to work, there are many places that we're needing help. Please be here. This is going to be a meeting like we've not had before. So I just really want everyone that can to get in here and get involved. And like I said, I know there's other things going on. We have another ladies' brunch that's coming up. And we just have several activities that's coming up in the next few months. Be praying for our youth camps that our kids are going to be going to in the month of June. One thing, Sister Diane, fill us in on Good Friday. That's right around the corner.
Basket for a child. Unisex is best. We are going to do some for girls and boys, but the more we can do that for either one would be great. But we're going to meet here at 10 o'clock, and the kids will put the basket together themselves, and then we're going to head out to a couple of locations and give them out to kids. And I'm just praying that God helps us target kids that just wouldn't get a basket. I mean, the ones that are just will be so you know, blessed and excited to have them, because they just wouldn't get one unless somebody gave them one. That's what I want to target.
That's this Friday. This Friday. So help us out. I'm going to ask if you would to stand with us one more time. I've asked the praise team to come back, and we're going to sing this song that talks about nothing but the blood of Jesus. Nothing but the blood. If it wasn't for the blood of Jesus Christ, you would not be here today. You would not know the power of salvation. Just worship the Lord.
What can wash away my sins? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What
Aren't you glad that the blood of Jesus still flows? Praise that wonderful name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I'm going to ask you this morning to go with me here to God's Word. We're going to start at the book of St. Matthew, chapter 6, the 19th verse, read down through 21. Hallelujah. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Nothing but the blood. Hallelujah. No substitution, is it? Without the shedding of the blood, he said, there is no remission of sin. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. It's hard to believe that next Sunday is going to be Easter. I'm not going to preach to you about Palm Sunday. I'm just going to preach to you what I feel like God has just laid up on my heart even a couple of weeks ago to be bringing to you this morning. I'm going to take you here to God's Word, and I want us to observe. I want us to absorb. I want us to think about the Word of God, the power there is in the Word of God, and especially whenever that Word is applied to our living. In verse number 19 of Matthew chapter 6 said, lay not up for yourselves treasures upon earth where moth and rust doth corrupt and where thieves break through and steal. But lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven where neither moth nor rust doth corrupt and where thieves do not break through and steal. Verse 21, for where your treasure is, there will your heart be also. Where your treasure is where your heart will be also. It's been said that if you want to find out the priority of a man or a woman, take a look at their checkbook. See what they spend most of their money on. Right? That pretty much tells you there's some people that that feel like that McDonald's. Some people think Chick-fil-A is. Right? Some people think Walmart. Everybody's getting the picture, right? I want God to really speak to our hearts this morning. Shall we pray together? Father, I give myself to you to be used of you today. God, I stand here as a messenger, as an ambassador of Jesus Christ. God, as I would speak upon your behalf today, I pray that every word that I would speak would be given to me from the Father. I pray for the Holy Ghost to confirm it. I just pray for the Holy Ghost to move upon us this morning. I thank you, God, for your presence. I've already felt. And I know, God, that you're in this house today. And, Lord, I just want to honor you. I ask you to, God, Lord, to please move up on us. And, Father, lead us and guide us as you speak to us. In Jesus' holy name, amen and amen. Hallelujah. Praise God. I want to talk to you about giving living. Giving living. We're going to take a little trip this morning through the Word of God. Socrates says, know thyself. Fruit said, be thyself. Jesus come along and said, give thyself. And if we can go back to the Word of God, we find that these are the teachings of Christ. Out of the 38 parables, 12 deal directly with the subject of money, giving, possessions. In the four Gospels, one verse out of every six deals specifically with some type of money. Jesus spoke more of money than any one of the so-called major doctrines of the church. And I believe it's because that God cares about our money. Not how much that we may have, but so much more on how that we spend it, how that we invest it, or even how we waste it. Amen. God's plan for us is simple and it is direct. It simply involves tithing and giving. The word tithe means a tenth. And I want you to hear me out this morning because it's like I told my Sunday school class today. I did not know what the Sunday school lesson was on until after the message God gave me. And our Sunday school lesson dealt with giving. And so the young adults are getting a double blessing this morning. It's not the same a message. It's not the same lesson, but it is upon the same topic. The tithe did not originate with Moses. Right. As many people believe that it originated during the time that God was setting up a structure or a plan for the children of Israel. The tithe actually originated with Abraham, who paid his tithe to Melchizedek, the king of Salem. Yep. Jacob, his grandson, comes along and promised God that if you would look out for me and take care of me and give me favor, and whenever I come back this way, I will tithe. I will give you 10% of my possession. I will give unto you a tenth. The tithing system was established then in the laws of Moses. Moses came along, God spoke unto him and instructed people on how to tithe. Often the prophets, the priests, reminded Israel of their responsibility to tithe. Malachi, the last book of the Old Testament, chapter 3, verse 10, comes along and he reminds the children of Israel, bring ye all the tithes into the storehouse. Bring them all in here. Prove me now herewith. See if I will not open unto you the windows of heaven and pour you out a blessing that there will not be room enough to receive it. This is the promises of God. All right? It is the promises of the Lord. And there is one thing that I have learned, and more so every day I'm learning this, that the dullest pencil is usually more reliable than the sharpest memory. Would you agree with me on that? Some of you act like that just went right on over your head. But that pencil, you can take it and you can write down something and then you will remember it. And if you don't remember it, go back and look at your notes. Right? Anybody ever have to do that? All the time. I have a little memo tab on my phone. And I'm constantly putting something in that to remind me. I have a calendar on my phone. I put stuff in that to remind me. If I don't write it down, I may forget it. So I learned to write it down. Why are you saying that? Because you may want to write down some of this stuff today. There's some things that you have to understand that the Word of God is just so plain on. And I don't understand why people find it so hard to follow God on it. I want to deal with actually five different principles this morning. So you really need to say amen a whole lot and help me preach so that way we can cover all five and it won't take very long. Yeah. Amen. Is that a deal? Amen. Amen. Those of you that want to go to Burger King real quick, you got to say amen real quick. So today, in the world that you and I are living in, it's get all you can all you get, and watch that can.
That's right?
Right? Simply get all you can all you get, and then watch that can. There's some people that worry themselves to death over their savings. John Wesley, an evangelist, a preacher, a pastor, he said, make all you can, save all you can, and give all you can. Wow. Charles Spurgeon, another minister, said, your hands cannot get heaven high until they get pocket deep. What is he saying? Sometimes the lack of giving hinders your worship unto God. Jesus not only come along commending tithing, he come along to reinsert and command tithing. The principles of giving and receiving are absolutely unfailing. If you put something in, you'll get something out. But whenever you put in your best, then you can get something better out than still what you put in. So sometime and give and never expect anything back in return. Now, I want you to listen to me. I've been raised in the church all of my life. And I've heard preachers get up there and say, hey, give and don't expect anything back.
Right.
You heard that? But did you know that's really contrary to the word?
That's right.
Now, he's talking about if you give to the poor, he said, don't expect the poor to give back to you. But he also said that if you give unto the poor, that the Heavenly Father in heaven is seeing what you're doing, and God will give back unto you. So whenever people are saying, just give and don't expect nothing back, I feel like that's contrary to the word.
Yes.
I feel like that if I'm obedient unto God, then I can expect God to honor his word in my life.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
I can expect God to give me something back in return, because after all, that's what he said he would do. Luke 6 and 38, a passage of scripture that many people have recited so many times, but yet the basics of that says, give and it shall be given unto you. So we are saying give and expect something in return. So maybe we do need to rethink our philosophy whenever it comes to giving. Because whenever you sow in God's garden, you can always expect to harvest a crop.
Right.
True?
Amen.
But you have to be willing to plant before you can see anything grow.
Yes.
And before you can get anything back.
Yes.
True?
Amen.
You have to be willing to plant something in there. I love the concepts of giving. I love the concepts of planting. My Lord, to see what one tomato plant can produce. What one orange tree can produce. You with me? What one vine can produce. And understand that God's the one that designed all of this to begin with. And God said, if you're willing to plant the tomato plant, then I'll give you tomatoes on that plant.
Right.
But if you don't plant the tomato plant, then don't complain whenever you do not have fresh tomatoes.
Right.
True.
Amen.
And so God help us to understand that this is where that it comes, even in our giving. So maybe we do need to rethink our philosophy. Principle number two, maybe we need to reset our priorities. Mm-hmm. In Matthew 6 and 33, he said, seek you first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these other things shall be added unto you. So maybe some of us need to reset our priority to say, I'm going to put God first. I'm going to seek God first. Whatever God wants, then that's what I want to do. Most of you are not necessarily from a city. There may be some of you, but I believe that most of us, if not all of us, have some type of a knowledge about farming, about planting. And so here's what I want you to understand, that if you take an ear of corn, just one ear, and you hold that ear of corn in your hand, and I know that it depends upon the size, but depending upon the size of that ear of corn also depends upon the size of a miracle. All right? Because in that one ear of corn, there is potential for many ears of corn. In that one ear of corn, on that one ear of corn, once again, it really depends upon what you're growing. My dad used to like to grow what they call the trucker's favorite. And then sometimes he'd go out and plant corn, and you'd look at it, and you'd think, my goodness, Dad, what did you plant? He said, I planted this corn for the hogs. And I planted it to where that we could grind it up. And I don't know where in the world he ever came up with this big old grinder that he had. And he'd get us out there to pick it. And sometimes a whole stalk. And he said, just put it all in there. Yeah. Some of the ears of corn looked like they had to be 12, 16 inches long.
Wow.
And I promise you, you really didn't want to eat it. But the cows and the hogs loved it.
Yeah.
Okay? And he'd try it out. And he'd put it down through that old grinder. And here come out all of this stuff that he'd mix it up in other feed. And I start looking at that. And if each kernel represented another stalk that would represent two or three more ears of corn that would produce the same amount. Yeah. Follow along with me. One ear of corn then had the potential to produce 500 million or a half of a billion ears of corn. Now that's not addition, that is multiplication. Right? So whenever you begin to realize, if I can take what God has given unto me and I can begin to use it like God said, and that is the principle of planting the best seed that I have. I've been to camp meetings. I've been in church services where that the preacher would preach about seed offerings, and he would make statements like, "What do you want God to do for you?" And he said, "This is a day that you can give in this offering, and we're going to call it a seed offering." And you know, whenever they first started coming out with a lot of that, I really just looked at them. Now, you have to understand that the only pastor I had was my dad. And my dad was a country boy. He raised hogs, he raised cows and rabbits and chickens and farmed and all that while coming up. And he had us boys out there milking cows and all of this stuff. And I had not never heard about a seed offering. But I do know that my dad loved to hold on to seed. And there was a reason for that. Right? Now, if you ate your seed, then you'd have no crop for next year. So you had to learn how to hold on to your seed so you would have a crop for next year. And whenever the seed offering concept began to really be preached, at first there's a lot of things that we begin to look at as variables and wonder if it really happened. But the Word of God has been proven time and time and time again. And the Lord simply said, "Give, and it shall be given." He also said that except that seed of corn is willing to be placed in the ground and die, he said, it will never grow. So you know what that tells me? What I give unto God, I have to release it unto God and to believe that God is going to cause what I have given unto him to come up and to prosper. Yeah. So it's not given to God with stipulations. It is giving unto God. Now that corn is done. Right? It can't think. It has no logic. It just simply does what God designed it to do. Some of us try to outthink God. Some of us try to outfigure God instead of just believing him that God will do what he said he will do. That corn, it cannot speak. It cannot sing. It cannot pray. It cannot witness. It cannot exercise faith. All that corn can do is simply fall into the ground where that the master's hands are planting it and yield unto God's resurrecting power, because God said, if you're willing to put that seed in the ground and let it die, I'm going to touch it and I'm going to cause it to come forth. And that which has been given unto me and died, now I'm going to resurrect it unto something greater than what you can ever imagine. And that is the power of an almighty God. And if God can do all of that for just one piece of corn, now what will God do for you and I?
Amen.
If we would have the faith, God loves us and God wants us to honor his name and he wants us to honor his word. He wants us to honor his plan. And if we do, then God will give us blessings. After all, Malachi 3:10, he said, "Prove me now herewith. See if I will not open unto you the windows of heaven. See if I will not bless you." And Luke 6:38, he said, "I'll give back to you again, pressed down, shaken together, and running over shall be given to your bosom." This is the word of God. And I want to tell you that God is not going to lie. God is going to honor his word. But God's looking for somebody who will honor God by keeping his word. Right? The Bible says this in Proverbs 3:9-10. He said, "Honor the Lord with thy substance and with the first fruit of all thine increase. So shall thy barns be filled with plenty and thy presses shall burst out with new wine." These are promises. This is what God is saying. Honor me with the first fruit of all thine increase. All thine increase. He said, give it to me. Honor me with it. And you know, as I was studying and preparing this, it's like the Spirit of the Lord put within me. He said, there are people that come to church and they have a spirit of rebellion when it comes to giving. They don't want to give like God said. And they'll do everything else except yield to God when it comes to tithe and offerings. But here's what it simply states. It means that if you've got to plant what you want. Do you want God's blessings?
Yes.
Then plant what God tells you to plant.
Right?
Right? And if I was to farm, if I wanted tomatoes, I would not go out and plant okra.
Right.
Right? Right. If I wanted corn, I would not go plant watermelons.
No way.
If I want corn, I want to plant corn.
Right.
And it's the same way with you and I. Whatever that you desire, what God puts within your heart, well then, friend, you be obedient unto God. The third principle is this. We need to rely on God's promises.
Yeah.
Yes, amen.
We need to rely on God's promises. That's what I do. I worship God in my offerings. I worship God through my tithing. But I still rely on the promises of God.
Yes,
right? You know I'm not a prosperity preacher. I don't go for all of that stuff. I do believe the word of God. And I believe that God is going to honor it because the promises of God are true.
Amen.
The principles that God has set up for giving and receiving are also true.
Yes. Yes.
I mean, you cannot get away from it. Sometimes we want to ignore the truth about it. But one thing I have noticed over the years, watching men that do not even profess to be Christians, yet they have used the principles of God and have become wealthy people. They have. Why? Because the principles of God are real. They are real. They work. God said, if you'll do this, I'll do this. And God simply said, if you'll put a seed of corn in the ground, he said, then I'm going to touch it and it's going to come back up. These are the things that God has done since the very beginning. Today, throughout the Mideast, many people there, they still dress like they did back in the Bible days. Okay? And I want you to understand this because in Luke 6 and 38, he said, I'll give unto you, pressed down, shaken together, and running over, shall men give into your bosom. Some of you may be saying, I don't want men to give into my bosom. So understand what he is saying here. In the Mideast, they would wear their robes, and often they were long, flowing robes, but they had a special compartment for valuables in the bosom area. And so whenever they had obtained valuables, that's what they would do. They would stick it into that pouch, and Jesus knew that. And so there was money that was carried there. There were jewels, there was silver, there was gold that was carried there. And so Jesus is simply saying, if you will give, it's going to be given back unto you, pressed down, shaken together, and running over, shall men give into your bosom.
Amen.
I believe that if we started believing the word of God, that we would go home and say, God, help me to get on a loose robe with a big pocket on the inside, because I believe your word. And if I will give as you have said for me to give, then God, my robe is going to be full.
Yeah.
Right? Now, there's another, one more time. Here is a principle of God. He said that if you sow sparingly, you will also reap sparingly.
Right.
True?
Yeah.
There's a lot of people today who say, well, I cannot afford to give no more unto God than this. You do not set your budget. You let God set your budget.
Amen.
You let God set your budget. Because if you will sow according to God, then God says, I am going to bless you. And so if you go out and you get you a little spoonful of seed. And let me back up here and say that this time, instead of planting corn, we're going to plant greens. Now, if you like collards, then you picture planting collards. If you like mustard, then you plant on mustard. If you like turnip, you get the picture. Why do you want to pick on that seed? Because that seed is small.
Yes.
Now, you can take you a spoon, just a regular spoon, and fill it up and say, well, that's all that I want. And that's all you're going to get.
That's right.
But if you take a can and fill it up, you're going to get more greens. True. And then if you really want a lot, then you can say, all right, it's not just going to be a spoonful. I want to go to a bucket. If you plant a bucket full of green seed, everybody in the church is going to have greens. Right? And then if you really want to get big and you just want to be a major farmer, get you a truckload. Because according to the seed you plant, will depend upon the size of the harvest you have. This is God's word. And it also goes back to you and I. We are the ones that set the limits on God. We are. I shared with you about the Joash Fund, of how that I had pledged. And I have actually pledged something that I knew would be very easy, because I already had it. And you may say, oh, preacher. Well, you do the same thing. At least go ahead and get it off your chest and be truthful. Amen. It's easy to pledge something to God that you already have. But whenever the Spirit of the Lord began to deal with my heart and said, I want you to give 10 times. Well, Lord, I've already given what I said I was going to give. I want the next pledge to be 10 times larger. Oh, Lord. That may take some doing. You're right. It's going to take me depending upon Him. Right? And so if I will plant the seed and be obedient unto God, then watch and see what God begins to bring up. How God begins to meet that need. And so now I'm not relying upon my abilities. I'm not relying upon my capability. I'm relying upon the word of the Almighty God. I'm relying upon the promises of God, that God will supply the need. I just have to be faithful unto Him. And I don't know about you, but today I do rely upon God. I rely upon the promises of an Almighty God. Whenever you rely on the government, guess what you're going to get? Just what the government gives you. Right? If you go back and rely on the church, depends upon the size of the church. Depends upon what you might be able to get from the church. True. But whenever you begin to rely on God, then you can get what Almighty God can do. Which is without limitation. No boundaries. And God Almighty is the one who can bless you. So not only do we need to rethink our philosophy, reset our priorities, and learn to rely on God's promises, we need to renounce our pride. How does all this go into giving, living? So many times our pride is what really keeps us from getting what God wants us to have. Right? So the Bible even teaches us to give in secret.
That's right.
And your Father which seeth in secret shall reward thee openly. So read with me Matthew chapter 6, 1 through 4. Take heed that you do not your alms before men to be seen of them. Otherwise you have no reward of your Father which is in heaven. Therefore when thou doest thine alms, do not sound a trumpet before thee, as the hypocrites do in the synagogues and in the streets, they may have glory of men. Verily I say unto you, they have their reward. But when thou doest alms, let not thy left hand know what thy right hand doeth, that thine alms may be in secret, and thy Father which seeth in secret himself shall reward thee openly. This is what God is saying. Sometimes you have to renounce that pride. You have to renounce that pride and realize that you're not given to be seen of men. If you give to be seen of men, then you receive your reward when men have seen what you've done. That's all you're going to get. You did it, so somebody pat you on the back. You got a pat on the back. You got your reward. Now listen to this. They say that there is different kinds of givers. First, there is the giver that is called the tipper. John Wesley had a solemn warning for all the tippers when we taught, give to God according to your income, lest God makes your income according to your giving. Well, we don't like that philosophy, do we? Here is the truth. 80% of all money given to God's work is given by only 20% of the Christians, while the other 20% of the money is given by the remaining 80% of the Christians. So you can be sure that the tempers are part of the 80%. Those of you that were with us Wednesday night, we found out that the same remains true right here in this church.
Yeah.
The second one is the emotional giver. Before he comes across, you have to give them some type of a sob story. You have to tell them a joke. You have to make them want to give through feelings. And they'll only give whenever they feel it. Third is the compulsive giver. This small minority of people gives indiscriminately to everything and everybody, even to a fault, sometimes to the very neglect of their own family. They're just going to give. Fourth is what they call the splash giver. Sometimes you see their picture in the paper handing a sizable check to maybe a pastor, to a college president, or to some government official. Once again, Jesus said, if you're going to be one of those splash givers, you're going to get what you are wanting. You're going to get your publicity. You're going to get your little bit of fame. And then don't expect the Heavenly Father to reward you because you got what you asked for. Fifth is the proportionate giver. They give systematically. They give regularly. They give faithfully. These are the people that keep the doors open. These are the people that keep the gospel going forward. They alone experience this special kind of joy that comes from being a cheerful giver. They also have experienced the truth of the scriptures where that he said, prove me now herewith, saith the Lord, and see if I will not open unto you the windows of heaven and pour you out a blessing that there shall not be room enough to receive it. These are the people that are saying, God, I'm standing on your word. I expect no recognition from any man. I only expect the fulfillment of God's word in my life because I am being faithful. I am keeping the covenant. I am keeping the commitment that I have made unto you. God, help us to do what God tells us to do and trust God for the rest.
Amen.
Right? And then number five, we need to be ready to receive.
Amen.
We need to be ready to receive. Several years ago, we were evangelizing, and there was a man that lived down around Everglades City, Chuck Alusky, and God had really blessed him. He was a pastor's son. He come up to me at camp meeting, and he wanted to give me some money. I said, no, man, I cannot take that. He said, yeah. He said, you need to take this. No. I can't take that from you. He says, you have to understand. He said, that you're keeping me from receiving a blessing.
Right.
Yeah.
If you don't take this.
Right.
You see, I'd rather be the one giving.
Yes.
But sometimes if you don't learn to receive, then you're not going to have anything to give.
Right?
And I think sometimes that we need to expect God to give unto us that we may be able to give. You see, the view of God giving in abundance is seen actually throughout the whole Bible. The Bible says that God is plenteous in mercy. He is plenteous to pardon people of their sins. He is plenteous in his provision for his people. And I think about what he told the children of Israel. He said, if you'll walk and keep my commandments, live in my covenant, he said, I'm going to bless you. He said, you can expect blessings. If you will just obey me, you can expect blessings. And so I'm telling you that, friend, whenever that you start keeping the promises of God and you walk in the covenant with God, then you can start expecting God to give to you to where that you receive plenty. My question is this. Do we really understand who we are? Oh, yeah, I'm just somebody who goes to church. No, do you really understand who you are as a born-again Christian? Listen to what Paul said. In Galatians chapter 4, verses 1 through 7, he said, now I say that the heir, as long as he is a child, differeth nothing from a servant, though he be Lord of all. But he is under tutors and governors until the time appointed of the Father. Even so we, when we were children, were in bondage under the elements of the world. But when the fullness of the time was come, God sent forth his Son, made of a woman, made under the law, to redeem them that were under the law, that we might receive the adoption of sons. And because you are sons, God has sent forth the Spirit of His Son into your hearts, crying, Abba, Father. Wherefore, thou art no more a servant, but a son. And if a son, then an heir of God through Christ. So what are you trying to say? I'm trying to tell you that we are a child of God. As a child of God, then we have the right to expect blessings coming from God. Right? We can expect our Heavenly Father to take care of us. There is a guy by the name of Shadrach Meshach Lockridge. Not Abednego. Alright? And he says that when we call him Lord, it simply means ownership. He owns it all. We call him Lord, don't we? Think about this. He did not write his signature in the sunset, but he still owns the sun. He did not carve his initials in the granite sides of the mountains, but he's still the owner of the mountains. He did not place his mark on the meadows, but he still owns the meadows. He did not burn his brand upon the cattle on a thousand hills, but the Bible said that they all belong to him. He did not copyright the songs that the birds sing, but he's still the owner of it. He's still the one that put it in their heart. He did not signal his name in a billion shimmering stars above, but he still owns all those stars, and he calls them all by name. Amen. Think about our God, and think about then who we are, because we are children of the Most High God. There's a lot of people today that come along and they try to discredit him, don't they? Some of them even try to destroy him. But you can just try to destroy him by fire, but he will not burn. You still with me? You can try to destroy him by water, but he walks on the water.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. You can try and destroy him by the whirlwind, but he will make the wind lie obediently at his feet. You can try to put him in a grave, but he has already proven that the grave cannot hold him, and he will rise and overcome and be victorious. And hallelujah, that's what we're going to be celebrating next weekend, isn't it? That our Lord is a risen Savior. Death cannot hold him. The grave cannot hold him. Why? Because he is Lord. He is the owner of it all. Hallelujah. He is still higher than the heaven of heavens. He's still holier than the Holy of Holies. He still stands forth upon the highest pinnacle of glory and proclaimed by God, acknowledged by angels, adored by the saints. He's feared by devils and he is revered by the redeemed. Why? Because Jesus Christ is the Lord of Lords. He owns it all. He owns it all. And I am his child. I am his child. Now listen, I'm going to close with this if the praise team will come back. And Proverbs 35 and 27 said that the Lord hath pleasure in the prosperity of his servants. If we can learn to make a lifestyle of giving to God. And can I tell you that this is an investment? This is an investment. Some people say, well, I'm going to pay my tithes this week and let's see how that this thing works out. I don't know a whole lot about stocks. But I do know enough about it to know that if you're going to invest in stocks, that it grows over time. It grows over time. Your investment has to be there. And it grows over time. And the thing is, the more that you invest in God, the greater it gets. The longer you invest in God, the greater it gets. You just cannot outgive God. We can believe God that God will save a man for the worst of sins and still find it difficult to believe God to take care of our financial needs through being obedient unto Him. Lord, you come too late to tell me that God will not keep His word.
Amen. Amen.
And some of you may say today, preacher, it's never been proven to me, and it may be because that you've never set out to prove God. I am Jehovah Jireh, thy provider, saith the Lord. I am the God that is with you, and I am the God that cares for you. If you will honor my word and keep my covenant, I will honor every word that I have spoken unto you through my word and into your spirit. I will fulfill it, saith God. I have not lied. I will not lie. There are not enough powers to keep my truth back from being fulfilled. I am a God that will keep my word. Honor me, and I will honor you, saith the Lord. You honor me, but not with all of your heart. I've asked my people to give unto me it all, as I have spoken unto you that the seed must die. Yet there are some things that you hold on to and will not allow to die, that I may give greater life. If you will commit, if you will give it all to me, saith the Lord, my hand will be great and it will be mighty. I've spoken unto you through my word. Now I speak to you through my spirit. Prove me now herewith, saith the Lord. See if I will not do what I have said I will do. See if I will not pour you out blessings if you will honor me and walk uprightly. And give as I have spoken unto your heart to give, saith God.
Praise God, praise God.
Will you stand with me this morning? You know, I've often said that preaching upon tithing and offering is one of the hardest things that I found in my ministry to do. But to be honest with you, it's getting easier. And the reason is, I know what God has done for me.
Yes.
And I know what God wants to do for you. And I know that if you will just depend upon God, that there is nothing impossible with God. You see, I know that there are times that I may not have all the money that I think I would like to have. But I know that I have all the God that I'll ever need.
Amen.
And He is the one that supplies my needs.
Amen.
I don't know how He's done it so many times. But He never leaves me. He never forsakes me. He never abandons me. And if I will honor Him, God said, I am Jehovah Jireh. I am your provider. And I will take care of you. This invitation that I'm going to give today is going to be quite simple. And you may say, Brother Spratt, why do you want to give one like this? Because I feel like what we need to do is maybe just come back and say, God, help me to give everything to you. I want to give to you my life. I want to give to you my time. I want to give to you my finances. God, I want to be like that piece of corn that is just cast into the ground. And I want to die. I want you to speak that resurrection into me. I want to live like you want me to live. Will you find your place to pray this morning and just say, God, help me to be resurrected in your power. Come on, everyone that will, find your place to pray. Let's ask God to touch our hearts today that we'll give. We will give to God like God wants us to give. Our heart, our soul, our mind, our talents, our finances. Whatever it may be, I give it to you, Lord.
Because of who you are. Oh,
He deserves all praise and glory and honor. God is worthy of it. I want you to take one thing that you know that God has done for you. Even it may be as early as this last week. Might have been the last couple of weeks, but you know that one thing God moved for you. And I just want you to lift your hands, and I want you to give special thanks, special praise unto Him for that. I want them to sing this chorus again, and as they do it, I just want you to praise Him. It might have been He brought you through a valley. He provided a need, but praise Him for who He is today. God, I worship You. Lord, I praise You for healing.
Because of who You are, I give You praise.
I praise You to God for Your excellent prayers.
Because of who You are, I will lift my voice and say, Lord, I worship You. Because of who You are, Lord, I worship You.
You are my
God
and who You are. If my children could only realize who I really am, I am not a fixture that is placed up in the church. I am God. I am God. I rule. I reign. My word is final. That which I speak is done. There is none to debate. There is none. There is none to rebel against my word. Those who come against my word are only met with swift defeat. My word is final. My word is final unto you, my children, this day, that if you will hearken unto me and serve me and know who I am, and you shall walk in places and you shall find that there is nothing impossible with my people who honor me and serve me with all of their hearts, saith the Lord.
Glory, 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 glory. Glory.
I worship you, Lord.
Hallelujah.
I worship you, Lord. I worship you, Lord. I worship you, Lord.
Glory, 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 glory.
I'm going to ask you to pray this morning. At the end of the service on Sunday morning, I normally present to you some of the prayer requests and ask you to pray. There are a couple of things I'm going to ask you to pray about, and then I'm going to ask you, if you will, to pray for one another. One thing is, I ask you to please continue to pray for my mom. They put her back in the hospital Friday. Don't know what all is going on with her yet. They're running more tests, but she's been very weak and she's very tired. This past Friday, Sister Spratlin went to the doctor and gave her a boatload of good news. about how that she could have some immune problem that is causing a lot of her problems. Told her that she has what is it called? Asthma. And all of this stuff. But I tell you, it's by his stripes
Amen.
That we're healed.
Amen.
By his stripes we're healed. You may be standing by someone today that may have a special need in their life, and you know it. Will you make a point of contact with them? Will you place your hand upon them even according to the word of God? And I want you to begin to pray for them. God, you're God that's going to move here in this Samoset church. God, we may not have 10,000, but we've got a God that's on the throne. And let's believe God today. Pray one for another. Pray one for another. Pray for your needs. Make your requests known unto him. Father, in the name of Jesus today. In the name of Jesus. God, for the sicknesses. God, for the sicknesses, Lord, that the doctors are trying to diagnose. God, I'm asking that by the stripes of Jesus Christ that they will all be gone. I'm asking you, Lord, to move upon the special needs of every person that is here today. For God, there are many here that have physical problems. God, there are some of them that are facing crisis in their home. God, there are some, dear God, that are facing, Lord, crisis on their job. God, Lord, there's some, dear God, that are just going through a spiritual warfare. But I am praying today that the holy hand of an almighty God that says that there is nothing that shall ever prevail against me, that this hand will be extended to heal those that are sick, to strengthen those that are weak, to encourage those that are discouraged, and to cause the gift of faith to be activated, to believe God for the impossible, to believe you, God, for the improbable, God, to believe you to God for that which man says cannot be done. God, we shall declare the word of God, and God Almighty shall mark it, and he shall declare it to be blessed. Oh, for you are God. You are God, and we worship you. You are the King of Kings, and you are the Lord of Lords.
And I worship you.
Nothing is too hard. Nothing is too great. Nothing is too mighty. God, it's just what I think to you. You speak your word, Lord, and it's done. You speak your word today, Lord, and there's healing to the body.
Lord, you
church. I sense God moving in this house. Somebody needs to just praise him for hearing your prayers. You need to praise him this morning, for you know that from here on out that God's going to be God. He's going to give you the strength to believe, to receive his power, to receive the promises, to receive the answers of his
strength.
Oh, yes.
Oh, my DC, Lord, you reign in victory.
yes.
Do you own?
Can you just give him can you give him glory for who he is? He's God.
Do you own? I sing this morning. Hallelujah. Because of who you are, I will live my life and say,
just because of who you are. Just because of who you are.